Scientists everywhere use a similar process to study the world. You might have heard it called the scientific method or scientific inquiry, but whatever you call it, doing science involves asking questions and methodically investigating answers. It all starts with observing and wondering. What do you see, smell, and hear? Part of the scientific process is making notes and keeping track of your questions. Otherwise, you might forget something important.
Once upon a time, there was a boy named John who liked to draw sketches of what he saw. One day while exploring, he discovered a rocky outcrop that was home for eastern phoebes. He noticed it had a dark bill, a white throat, a faint yellow belly, and when it puffs up its crest, he noticed the bird's head is big compared to its body. He watched it for a while and noticed the phoebe pumps its tail up and down a lot when it's perched on a branch. He wondered, how do they make their nests? How many eggs do they lay? Why do phoebes sing more in the morning?
So John had moved to the next step in the scientific process, and this can be one of the hardest things about the process of science, asking questions in a way that makes them suitable for an investigation.
But I thought all questions are good. Right? I've heard there's no such thing as a bad question.
Yes, but some are pretty hard to test. For example, back to John's question, why do phoebes sing more in the morning?
Yeah, I wonder, why do they sing at all? Is it because they're happy? Are they hungry or lonely? Are they musical? Is it the weather or because they're looking for a friend? There are so many possible explanations. So many variables.
As a scientist, you could ask questions all day. The trick is to narrow one down and get specific. With John and his eastern phoebes, maybe it went something like this. I wonder where the phoebes are going. Do phoebes migrate? Well, yes. Will phoebes come back to this area next year? Maybe. Will phoebes come back to this nest? Will these phoebes come back to this nest next year?
This is an interesting question because John noticed that most birds abandon their nests when their chicks are grown and don't usually come back next year. Now, John had observed the phoebes in the same nests on the rocky outcrop for a few years in a row. He wondered if this year's birds were the same birds that were here last year. Maybe some were and maybe some weren't. It was a mystery he thought he could solve.
And because his question focused on things that were observable, measurable, and repeatable, he was off to a good start. He was ready for that next step in the wheel. Hypotheses are the possible answers to your research question. With this step, be sure you list all possible outcomes, including the possibility that you might find no difference or no relationship in your study subjects.
John proposed three possible answers to his question. Number one. The same phoebes will come back to the nest they used the previous year. Number two, eastern phoebe nests are reused the next year, but by different birds. Number three, phoebes are equally likely to use their old nests or different nests if they're returned to an area.
Number three is the null hypothesis, where there is no difference in the likelihood that phoebes return to their old nest or to a different nest.
Uh-oh, I see a problem. All the eastern phoebes look alike. How will he know if the same birds come back?
You've hit upon the most important thing that happens throughout this whole scientific process. Reflect and rethink. A scientist is constantly rethinking, making sure the ideas still make sense and the plans will work. It's like solving a puzzle.
So, how will John know which birds are in his study group and which are not?
As a scientist, now you're in the plan and test phase of your investigation. This is when you decide what science tools to use to help gather data. This is when you think about how to be sure that your methods are consistent, objective, and fair.
In order to keep track of his study group, John knew he needed to mark the birds somehow. He had an idea. He would capture a few birds and secure a silver wire to their legs to mark them as his test group before they fly south for the winter. He made little marks on the wires so he could tell them apart. The banded group of birds migrated south just before the snow flurries came. The following spring, John got the answer to his research question. Of the 10 nests from which he tagged Phoebe's, 8 of them had the same exact bird's return.
Hold on. I think we've skipped a few things. Once the data are gathered, a scientist will summarize and explain what they found. They might use charts and graphs and sometimes a lot of math to figure out what the data mean. For example, what about the birds that came back to the site that didn't have bands?
They either lost their bands or weren't part of the study.
Okay, so what are the data?
It looks like this. John attached silver bands to birds in the fall. The birds were gone all winter, and in the spring, 16 birds, 8 pairs, returned to the same nests. A new pair moved into one nest, and one nest was abandoned.
We definitely found evidence to support hypothesis number 1. The same Phoebes will come back to the nest they used the previous year. Well, okay, one new pair moved into the neighborhood, but most of the nests were used by the same birds. To make a conclusion, we'll look at the data and decide which hypothesis is best supported by the evidence. If the data don't reflect what the scientists thought would happen, or the data are confusing, that's okay. That just means the outcome was unexpected, which means there's more to learn, which means more science is needed. And scientists are always learning from their investigations and from each other. This is why it's so important for any scientist to share their findings. Some scientists publish scholarly articles in peer-reviewed journals.
Some make a YouTube video. Or you could give a presentation. You could even write a letter to the editor. In John's case, he made notes in his journal. Want to know the year?
Okay.
1803. Want to know who he is?
Yeah.
Oh, I think you'll know him. It's John James Audubon. He was an artist and a naturalist. He was just 18 years old when he made scientific history, the first recorded scientist to conduct a bird binning experiment in North America.
An artist, a scientist, a curious person like you and me.
I've been thinking about the Phoebes. I wonder where they go in the winter. Do you think they go to the same place every year, or do they go to different places?
Oh, great question. How would you investigate that?
Little tiny cameras or satellite tracking devices, maybe?
And because of the trailblazing work of John Audubon and more who followed, we have rules now to protect birds. The International Migratory Bird Treaty makes sure that any handling of birds today is only by trained experts.
I'd like to become a trained expert. It sounds like fun.
All right, let's start at the beginning. What's your research question?
We should tell you that when we wrote this story, we made up some of the numbers to illustrate the practices of science.
We don't have many specific details about John's investigation, but we do know Phoebes often do return to the same nests from summer to summer, unlike many other bird species.
And historical records suggest that John James Audubon really was the first person in North America to put bands on birds' legs. And the first birds he banded really were Phoebes. Look it up and see for yourself.